I'm Kathy Baldock, and I run a ministry out of Reno, Nevada called Canyonwalker Connections. And I have the name of Canyonwalker Connections because in 2001, I was a completely non-affirming Christian, so that's 15 years ago. And I think I was pretty typical of evangelical Christians even today. I believed that LGBT people had made a choice of their sexual preference, I would have even said. And I didn't think you could be both gay and Christian. And what happened was I was going through a divorce. And as I was going through a divorce of a 20-year marriage, and I had even homeschooled my children, so I was in this pedigree of this evangelical bubble. And within that pedigree, it was quite an embarrassment to be going through a divorce. And what it did was, internally, it undermined my ability to tell other people what to do. So I have a gift of evangelism. And so what my normal procedure would be is if I found out if you were gay or a lesbian, you know, you'd give me about 15 minutes with you, and I would push you and mold you in the right way and ask questions and get you to say the sinner's prayer, and then, you know, we'd be good because you'd be on your way to heaven within a half hour. But it's a gift. Not many people have it. But as I was going through a divorce, it was very difficult for me to tell other people what to do because my own life on the outside was falling apart. So at the same time, my husband had committed adultery, and I did not want to commit adultery. So I kept myself very busy. And the two things I did to keep myself busy were to keep my mind busy. I went to the community college and took Italian class because languages are my most difficult, intellectually, languages are the most difficult thing I can learn. And I also started hiking every single day. And on my hiking trail, I, of course, ran into a lesbian who became my hiking partner. I didn't know anybody that was self-identified as LGBT. And she is, she's not an agnostic anymore, but she is a Native American, Hispanic last name, woman of color, agnostic, lesbian. Everything I am not. And because we were so well paired in terms of hiking together and enthusiasm about hiking, we started bonding, and every week I would hike with her. And at the end of the year, when she finally came out to me, it didn't matter to me that she was a lesbian, and through relationship, I learned a lot. Because I had, as I said, believed that you couldn't be gay and Christian, and that people had made a choice to be gay. And the other person, so when I started taking Italian class, the first night of Italian class, of course, the person I was partnered up with was the only gay man in the class. So all of a sudden, I had a gay man and a lesbian in my world, which caused me to just think about what I thought about LGBT people in the church. And I could handle that, and I could, you know, within a few years, I could even understand that gay people had the right to civil rights, perhaps even get married, but I wasn't even challenged to think about theology in terms of sexual orientation, gender identity in the Bible, because none of the people I met over the next 5 years identified as both gay and Christian. Until in 2006, I saw an article in the New York Times featuring Justin Lee of the Gay Christian Network. It was the first time I had ever seen the words gay and Christian together before. And because I'm intensely curious, I tracked that boy down. I got him on the phone, and I asked him, can I come to your conference? I noticed on the website that he was having a conference in Seattle. So in 2007, I went to the Gay Christian Network conference in Seattle, and I was the first straight person to go. And first night in worship, the first night Thursday in worship, there were about 200 gay Christians, no trans people had shown up yet. And I realized that when they were worshiping God, they were worshiping the same God I was, with the same intensity and connection to the Holy Spirit, which pretty much devastated me because it connected in my heart, but I couldn't get it to connect in my head for a while. So I was given some very good advice to just hang around with LGBT people, and I did. So I hung out with LGBT people. There's a church in San Francisco, Freedom in Christ Evangelical Church, which is about 4 hours from me. I'm in Reno, Nevada. And they were very inviting, and they let me come into their community and ask all my stupid questions. And if you were my friend at the time, you would know I asked a lot of stupid questions. And they were just very inclusive of me. So along the way, I got to understand gay Christians. But it wasn't until about a year after that that I started challenging my own theology on this. So I sat down and I studied the Bible, and I came out fully affirming by studying each passage of scripture. But when I would try to have conversations with other straight Christians, we kept getting stymied around, well, that's your interpretation of the Bible, and that's my interpretation of the Bible. So I began to think about how I could have these conversations and not get stuck all the time on that's your interpretation, this is my interpretation. And this is what I came up with. So let me start here. So I was trying to find other ways to have conversations because I was realizing that it wasn't good enough just to have this disagreement where people said, well, that's what you believe and this is what I believe, because I could see the effect, the impact of misused scripture or damaging scripture on the lives of LGBT people. So I kept trying to figure this out. And I would ask questions, where did that come from? Where did that come from? Where did that come from? And I realized that I couldn't just stick in scripture, because what we tend to do is we tend to stand here in 2016, and this timeline is proportional around the room. So I would look all the way back in time to the first century, all the way back around this room to the first century, and I would look at what Paul said in the first century, and I would assume, this is what we do, I would assume that he knows the same thing that we know in 2016 about human sexuality and about the relationship and the roles between men and women. And all of this, you have to ignore all of the stuff that's going to happen to think that Paul understood that what he was writing about was not same-sex relationships, but actual homosexuals. So I started digging and digging and digging. So that's what we're going to go through, and we're going to go through pretty quickly. Normally I do this in 5 hours. Yeah. So we're not going to do it in 5 hours. So let's just look. So the first thing we're going to look at is how people have seen same-sex behavior through history. So here's how we've seen it. So any time that somebody would have looked at some kind of same-sex behavior before about 1860, now my lines are going to be kind of nebulous. I'm going to say, here's some defining dates, but there's going to be tons of overlap. So same-sex behavior before about 1860 would have been seen as lust, excess, violence, in the case of Genesis, and even rape, okay? And there would have always been a differential, a difference in age or power between people. So it would have been a man with a male and usually a boy. So if we would see same-sex behavior any time before this, so this includes ancient cultures too, it will be a man with a boy or a man with someone in lesser power, so there would be always an age or a power differential, and it would have been based in lust, excess, violence, or rape. Okay? And there would, and the people would have been, if it would have been, this one would have been seen as taking the woman's role, as the penetrated, and the male, as long as he kept the penetrator role, the role is the penetrator, everything's good in manland, right? As long as one man is taking the role of penetrator, it's going to start to shift somewhere about this point. But before here, so we have to remember, it's about the role you take in sex, completely about the role. So it's the role you play, the role played. And in 1868, a man comes along named Kurt Benny. He's a Hungarian journalist, and he's in Austria. And a lot of the early sex studies are in Germany and Austria. And he starts to notice that there are men that he's working with in the bookbinding business of equal status that seem to be falling in love with one another. So this is defying this age or power differential because they're of equal status. So he's wondering why that is, that there are men falling in love with men of equal status. And so he thinks, how am I going to, I'd like to describe what's happening here. So he's the first person in history that comes along in 1868, and he said, I'm not going to define human sexuality, which really wouldn't have been a term, but it's a term we understand. He's going to define human sexuality by who you're attracted to. You see the difference here? It's not the role you play, it's who you're attracted to. So he defines several kinds of people. He says, there are people that seem to be... there are people that seem to be attracted to the opposite sex, attracted to the same sex, attracted to children, and to animals. And we are going to call these people heterosexuals. Heterosexuals. Because men at the time, at any time in history, men could basically do whatever they wanted to with their bodies as long as they played the role of the penetrator. So the age of consent in most of the United States, even at the turn of the century in 1900, was 12 to 14 years old. Men could do whatever men wanted to do with their bodies. And these people that were attracted to men, same sex, opposite sex, children or animals, called heterosexuals, most of them would go on to marry women. So, and they played the role. They played the role of the male, but it was about who they were attracted to. And he says, we're also going to see that there are homosexuals, and those are people that are attracted to the same sex. And then there are monosexuals. Those are people that are attracted to themselves, masturbators. And then there are natural sexuals. Those are people that are only attracted to the opposite sex. So here we are in 1868. Somebody is going to say, it's not about the role you play, it's about who you're attracted to. But things didn't change immediately. So it has to now travel through the culture, and it travels incredibly slowly, very slowly. The first time it's going to end up in a medical conference as a discussion is in 1901. It's very slow. It's 33 years. The first time it ends up in a medical dictionary is 1911, heterosexual and homosexual. The first time it ends up in an American dictionary is 1934. So before 1934, you really couldn't have said homosexual and heterosexual and have had anyone understand you. So that's one of the defining points. Okay. And so, as long as it played, I'm going to continue to say it, as long as a man played the role of a male and he was the penetrator, everything is good in manland. So there's this long flex time where we don't quite understand what's going on, but men still being penetrator is important. So it's going to start to shift again, and they were going to look at the culture. The culture is going to start to change. Around the 1900s, a couple of things are going to happen in the United States. About this period of time, there is a very long drought in the United States. You wouldn't think that droughts and industrial revolution would be connected to human sexuality, but they are. And so there's a very long drought in the United States, over 10 years, and a lot of the people start moving off the farms and into the cities. And there's also the industrial revolution, and people are start moving into the cities, and immigrants are coming into the cities. So for the first time, there are huge populations in the cities, and also for the first time, people are being exposed to perhaps populations what they wouldn't have been exposed to, and they're feeling this other thing going on in what we would call their sexuality. Maybe out on the farm, they couldn't express it. You know, maybe Bobby Joe couldn't have understood why he wasn't attracted to Betty Lou, but now he gets into the city and, oh my goodness, William is looking pretty hot to him, right? So he gets to try this out. He's in a new environment. 50% of the American population moves towards the cities, and the cities become environments of single, that people end up in single sex environments. Men end up, 40% in New York City at the turn of the century, 40% of the men in New York City over the age of 15 were not married, which was very unusual. And also, women are, for the first time, also in single-sex environments, because in the 1860s, when the Civil War happened and women weren't allowed in but 5 colleges. Now they're starting to get into the colleges because all these spaces open up for women. They go to college. They not only get educated, they also end up in single-sex environment with other women. So women are starting to also be exposed to women in environments, and they're gonna start changing. And but again, it doesn't particularly matter what women do with their bodies, because women are the lowest of the low anyway, and it doesn't matter if they're penetrated or unpenetrated. It's just what a man does with his body. But women start hanging out together too, and they end up in these things called, when they start, it's pretty funny, when they start cohabitating, nobody imagines that they're doing anything sexual, because women are not sexual beings. We don't even find out until 1956 that women have orgasms, right? So, I mean, they could have asked, but they didn't ask. But Masters and Johnson, because there's no proof, right, that women are, well, there's proof, but there's no proof that women are having orgasms. So this whole period of time, there's the suspicion that women that are living together are enjoying sex together. They're not, because women aren't sexual beings. So women that are cohabitating are it's called a Boston marriage that they're cohabitating in, but people can't imagine that there's anything sexual going on anyway, okay? So let's go to this next period. So we understand that things are changing. By the 1920s, we start to see in the roaring 20s, we start to see that there are more men hanging out with equal status men. And there's no way to explain why a man is in a relationship with a man, because men should only be in relationships with women. So the way they try to understand this is, if we have two men and they are attracted to one another, and men are only supposed to be attracted to women, one of these men must, on the inside of him, in his psyche, be a female. So one of these men must be a female on the inside for two men to be attracted to one another. So what we're going to call these people at this time is sexual inverts. Okay? You can see that. Because one of them has their sexuality inverted on the inside. So they're still not understanding why people of men of equal status are attracted to men of equal status. And they're trying to find reasons why this is happening. So sexual inverts becomes a term until probably about the 1950s. You still find it in literature. Now, to prove that men in relationship with men, that one of them should be or was perceived as a woman, all we have to do is look at language. So when men were attracted to another man, the one that was in the penetrated position was seen as different words: Molly, Pansy, Nancy, and he was also seen as a fairy. These are all terms for men with a penetrated partner. And there was also words that started coming up. Let's talk about the word faggot. 1G. Now, faggot had been a slang word in the 1800s used in England, and the word was associated with a shrewish old woman. So the shrewish old woman that had been disregarded by both men and her culture, she might have been bent over, and she would walk through the streets picking up bundles of sticks, which were in French a faggot, and she would pick up the bundles of sticks to keep her warm and to cook her food. And she was dismissively called, she was a castaway woman, and she was dismissively called a faggot. And that word then transferred into our language for the penetrated man. First, it was an owned word, okay? So it was an owned word. But all of these words show you that in this relationship between two men, one of them was always considered female. And they still don't understand why. They can't get their grasp on this thing, but one of them was perceived as female. And the other word is gay. in the 1700s, it's G-A-I. In the 1700s, that word, G-A-I, was associated with a female prostitute. And when she would have sex, fornication for a female prostitute was to gay it. And it wasn't associated with happy or merry at this time. It was associated another dismissive word towards woman. And then in the 1700s, the late 1700s, that changed to a Scottish term called gay cat or gay catamite. And a catamite is kind of like a servant or a valet. And so the hobos along the railroads in the 20s and 30s, they would have like a male servant boy with them. And that boy that they brought along on the railroads with them that did all of their work, their extra work for them, but that person was also usually a sexual slave, that boy was called a gay cat. And then again, that got shortened to gay. So all of the words that were being that were used to refer to men that were being penetrated were all associated with women, okay? So if that's even gonna start to change. Let's go to another timeline. Let's go to purple. Okay. So as I said here, nobody's quite understanding what's going on here. It's kind of a mystery. What is this attraction between men and men? And again, we're not going to talk too much about women. Actually, the first person that's going to start to talk about women is in 2006. Women aren't important. What women do with their bodies doesn't matter because you're the lowest of the low, and it doesn't matter what women do with their bodies. Dr. Lisa Diamond, she starts doing tests on female sexuality. Until then, it was assumed that female sexuality was just like male sexuality, which is, you know, who got that one, right? I mean, that doesn't make sense at all. So they're taking what they're learning about men, they're ignoring women, sometimes they're putting it onto the lives of women. In the turn of the century, in 1900s, Freud comes along, and he starts the school of psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis comes from, in the 1870s, psychology. It's the first time psychology starts. So people start talking about their feelings in the 1870s for psychology. A lot of things start happening in the 1870s. So in the 1870s, here's kind of where you can block it, where we are in culture, what we understand. You can just take the year 1870. This is about when one man, Carl Kurt Benny, comes along and he says, maybe it's not about the roles people play in sex, but it's who they're attracted to. And also in 1870, psychology starts. Why are people operating the way they're operating? And, you know, maybe we can help them by just talking about this. And also in 1870, scientists figure out that it's an egg and a sperm that makes a baby. 1870. So you can, this all falls into the same paradigm of a woman was just a fertile planting ground for a sperm, and they thought the sperm contained the total of a human being. Okay? So this is why masturbation was such a problem to some people, some church fathers. So church fathers have said, and I believe it's St. Thomas Aquinas, if it's not, I'll correct it, but St. Thomas Aquinas says, it is better to endure rape or incest than to masturbate. Because at least with rape or incest, there's a potential for procreation. So masturbation was obviously a problem to them, but they didn't understand until 1870 that it was an egg and a sperm. So before this, human sexuality was a very primitive topic. So in 1870, things are gonna start to change, and psychology starts, and it doesn't get any credence until about the First World War, and during the First World War, men go off to war, and they come back incredibly broken. And before this, mental health problems, what you call mental health, it was usually associated with bad blood, bad genes, bad stuff going on in your families. And then all of a sudden, after people come back from the war, we understand that people are getting broken because of their experiences. So now psychology gets a little footing as something credible. Freud comes along, and Freud is now looking at these people, these sexual inverts, these pansies, these Nancys, and he's saying, where do these people come from? Why are they this way? So he comes up with several theories. And some of one of the most popular theories he comes up with is a smothering mother and a distant father. We've heard that, but actually we're still hearing it, aren't we? Mm-hmm. So he says, smother mother, distant father, that's what's making homosexuals and sexual inverts. But by the end of his own life, in 1939, he writes a letter to an American mother, writes to him and says, my son is a homosexual. What can I do to fix my son? And he writes back to her and says, nothing. There is a spectrum of human sexuality. Your son is just on this piece of the spectrum. Don't worry about it. You can't do anything to fix him. So that was Freud in 1939. So how did we get so mixed up as to what human sexuality is and why homosexuality is a mental illness? Now we're going to go into that stage of it. We have to go to the war again. History is intertwined through all of this. History, psychology, medical things, all of this stuff. So let's go back to the, sorry about this. Have to keep getting new pens. Let's go back to the war. So the war starts happening in the 1930s and 40s. Well, Hitler's people start causing trouble in Germany. Germany and Austria were the center of human sexuality studies. By about the 1920s, there was a sex institute in Berlin that had 10,000 records of sexual inverts. So they were already studying sexual inverts, and that institute was burned down by the Nazis. So everything is burned down, that those records are gone, and the people that were the psychologists, the psychoanalysts that were studying human sexuality, they were German Jews predominantly. So when the war comes along, they emigrate. They are forced to emigrate out of Nazi Germany. And they go to either England, a lot of them go to England, but some of them come to the United States in the 1930s and 40s with very progressive understanding of human sexuality, but they are German and they are Jewish. And there were two things that we did not like in the United States in the 30s and 40s, Germans and Jews. So these psychologists that had quite a bit of understanding of human sexuality, they regressed. They fit into the Victorian era of the United States, and they became very regressive. And they started coming up with theories as to why these people were sexual inverts. And there were all kinds of theories they came up with, but they started in about the mid-1930s, and they go all the way until about the 70s, trying to explain why people are sexual inverts. Why are they missing? Why are they not attracted to women? And the thing they come up with is, not that, here it was a mystery. They don't understand what's going on. It's a total mystery. But now, in this period, oh, we understand what it is. They are sexually broken, so they don't listen to their own father of psychoanalysis, Freud. They say they're sexually broken or they are mentally ill. Absolutely no studies are done to come up with these ideas. One of the most famous one of these psychoanalysis was Edmund Bergler, who in 1962 wrote a book, and he said in his book that 27% of the people that came to him were changed, 27% of the homosexuals were changed to heterosexuals. Another third had lessened homosexual tendencies, and another third were just not motivated to do anything, and they were still homosexuals. So he wrote this book in 1962. In his 30 years of practice, he had 11 homosexuals, because I'm going to use the terms that were current at the time. He had 11 homosexuals in his practice of 30 years. He never looked outside into the culture to see how other people were operating. He berated all of his clients. They said at the end of his career, even the American Psychoanalytical Association said he was one of the most cruel members they ever had. And he wrote, so he writes this book in 1962. And because I am such a footnote reader, I will tell you that some of the family organizations, even today, Family Research Council and a lot of the traditional family organizations, they will still cite this book from 1962 in their footnotes as real. One-third, one-third, one-third. You wonder where you've heard that from? 1962. So now we're going to drop that again, and we're going to go back into the culture. Oh, and there's just, I can't go into it in this short video, but there are so many ideas they came up with. They were trying to figure out, what is it possibly that we can do to people to not make them homosexual anymore? Well, maybe they're not getting enough testosterone. So maybe a solution would be, okay, like, gentlemen, time to grab the genitals, because here it goes. Maybe you're not getting enough testosterone because your testicles aren't making it. So maybe if we take the testicles off a cadaver and take your testicles off and sew on the testosterone producing testicles onto you, maybe you won't be homosexual anymore. Maybe we can inject you with hormones. Maybe we can do some behavioral science with you, train you, like show pornography, gay pornography, and every time you're shown gay pornography and you start to react, we're gonna shock you, electroshock therapy, also give you drugs so that when we electroshock you, you're gonna throw up. Oh, another good idea might be to give you a lobotomy. So why don't we just stick an ice pick through your eye orbit, scramble your brains around a little, and that will make you not homosexual anymore. A lot of interesting ideas. So now let's go back into the culture and see. So now we're here. We're here along this medical timeline. And the people that are most informed about this are telling us that these homosexuals are broken and mentally ill. So now let's go back into the culture and see what's happening in the culture. So the World War II ends. And as people come out of the war, the GI bills say that you can come out and you can buy a house, maybe a dollar down, no interest. So what happens is the baby boom era. Women go home. 80% of women at the time were in the workforce. Women go home and they have babies earlier in their lives, more frequent and more babies. It produces the baby boom. But what it does within the culture is it shows us who's not getting married. So we start to see this heteronormative, the traditional American family is created. Before this, this was, historians call it, the creation of the traditional American family. So homosexuals start to stick out a little more. We're still not going to use the word gay. Gay is kind of a code word. The first time gay is ever going to get used within in a gay organization is going to be 1972. So it's still not a word that we're using. So gay people start to stick out a little bit more, and the government, with just some, there are bigger stories, but the government, Truman passes, Eisenhower passes, Executive Order 10450, and Executive Order 10450 says that no homosexual or someone suspected of being homosexual can be hired by the State Department or the Department of Defense or anyone holding a contract for those people. This is right after the Second World War. Because we were very afraid in this country of this communist invasion. It was the Cold War. So somehow people started in conflating in their minds that communists equal sexual perverts equal homosexuals. Communists were behind every parked car, homosexuals behind every parked car. Communists could be blackmailed, homosexuals could be blackmailed. Communists wanted to recruit your children, homosexuals wanted to recruit your children. And then when the Cold War was over, thank God we still had homosexuals to blame all our fear on. So this panic hit the United States. And I don't know if I can see some of you in this room are about my age, So I was born in 56, I'm 60. I was born in this age, and I remember the panics in the United States of every outsider. We were so fearful of everything, and we were also fearful of homosexuals. Well, this Executive Order 10450 surfaced through the McCarthy era, people that were homosexual. 20% of the jobs in the United States were associated with the State Department, the Department of Defense, or contracts with the United States. So now, look what's happening in the culture. We can see who's homosexual. We can see who's not heterosexual anymore because they're not fitting within that traditional normative. The government is not hiring those people they're trying to hide. When we figure out maybe who some of these homosexuals are, they get arrested for having private, consensual sex. They get shipped off to prisons. At one time in Southern California, not too far from where we are, Atascadero State Mental Hospital, 4,500 gay people were in there in the early 50s, and most of them were subjected to lobotomies to make them not homosexual anymore. And most of them were caught for consensual, private sex acts. So where are we? The medical community is telling us gay people are mentally ill. They're sticking out within the culture, and the government is targeting them too. Not a good time to be a gay person. Not a good time at all. Okay, next step. Inside of the medical associations, the American Psychological Association, the American Psychoanalytical Association, the American Psychiatric Association, they're all starting to talk about what do we do with the homosexuals? Because they're starting to pop up. We're starting to see them. We know they're mentally ill. We know we don't want them in society because we're being told that they undermine not just the family, but they undermine the country. So we don't want these people in our communities. But with inside of those mental health organizations, the professionals are starting to try to have a conversation because some of them are closeted gay people. So the conversations start happening in about this area, but the one that starts it, it's one of my favorite stories in the book, is a woman named Evelyn Hooker. Evelyn Hooker. And she asks a simple question in 1951, and she answers it in 1955, right in there. She says, we keep talking about homosexuals in therapy. Maybe someone should look at homosexuals not in therapy, homosexuals in the community that seem to be acting quite fine. They might be hiding because of all this pressure on them, but let's look at them. And she does a study, and she gets 30 homosexuals and 30 heterosexuals of equal status, money, education, and she gives them 3 tests, and then she takes those papers, shuffles them up, gives them to the creators of these psychological tests and says, pick out the homosexuals. And they can't, because the homosexuals and the heterosexuals come up the same on these psychological tests. So she's the first one that has research that says there's nothing mentally ill or broken about homosexuals. So in 1955, 56, she gives the results of her presentation to the American Psychiatric Association and a totally hushed room. And of course, everybody applauds her and everything changes. No. And why? Because she's a woman. She's a woman. So no one listens to her. So this is 1955. So in 1955, they've got proof. Then the National Institute of Mental Health asks her again in 1969, 14 years later, to write a paper on her findings because gay people are starting to come out of the closet. 1968, Stonewall's already happened, right? So gay people are starting to come out of the closet. The government's trying to figure out what to do with gay people. She writes her paper. It goes to the Nixon administration, and they publish it because it's wonderful. No. It's 1968, hippies, anti-war, civil rights, feminism. All of this unrest going on, the last thing you need are gay people being made, you know, normal and starting to rebel as well. It was a time of unrest in the 1960s. But what happened was an unauthorized copy of her report made into the hands of gay activists. So over the next 3-year period, gay activists start pushing from the inside, the closeted ones. From the outside, they start showing up at the APA conventions and saying, stop talking about us and start talking to us. And in 1973, homosexuality is lifted. It's no longer a mental illness. So no longer, okay? Whoop. And of course, everything gets great then. No, 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 it doesn't. It should have. Everything should have been a party right then. Actually, by 1972, non-discrimination acts had started being passed in the United States. There were municipalities and cities and counties that were saying, we're gonna stop discriminating against people for their sexual preference, okay? So now we're gonna call it a sexual preference for a while. We're still not to orientation. So how does religion get in this mess? Sexual preference. Now we're gonna start on religion. And we're gonna run through religion, because we're gonna get to the verses. Okay, so we're gonna stop it right there. Gay people are no longer mentally ill. Have I said anything about the Bible?
No.
Nothing. All the discrimination at this point is wrong mental health assumptions, pressure from the culture, pressure from medical associations, pressure from the government. There's no pressure happening from churches. So how do we have this understanding that churches have always caused this problem with gay people, or, you know, God has always been against gay people? Okay, now we're gonna go back. We're not gonna cover this. I covered it in my book, chapter something, chapter 4 or 5. Oh yeah, I wrote a book. I'll get there. Oh yeah, I wrote a book. I spent a lot of time as a hermit. Yeah, writing a book. Okay, very quickly. The Scofield Reference Bible in 1909 gets printed. Scofield Reference Bible on the side of the thing tells us, you know, this verse is related to this verse. But what the Scofield Reference Bible also said was that the Bible is divided into 7 segments, right? Dispensations. And when the First World War happened, it looked like we were in the 7th dispensation and the end of time was coming. And evangelicals, capital E, took a parting of the ways. The more justice-oriented evangelicals that started paying attention to the plight of the people in the cities during the Industrial Revolution, women's rights, the rights of children, they were called the modernists, the people that saw the end of time coming, that said, we've got to get out there and start telling people to turn to Jesus. They were called the fundamentalists, capital F. We're just going to let them sit for a minute. 1924. Scopes monkey trial. Again, I cover it well in the book, but the Scopes monkey trial puts on trial essentially the modernists against the fundamentalists. The entire United States hears this debate in an eight-day radio program, and they hear how ridiculous fundamentalism sounds. To them, it sounded ridiculous, and the fundamentalists are kind of pushed into a closet. And so they go into this enclave, and they sit in this enclave where they don't want to associate with anybody else outside of their fundamentalist community. I mean, it is a complicated story, but they don't want to associate with people outside their fundamentalist community. And they say, we're not going to get involved in other churches, in politics, nothing. Billy Graham was part of that movement in the 50s, and then he got caught praying with, I think, a Methodist, or it could have been a Presbyterian, one of those heretical things, right? And he was kicked out of his fundamentalist group because he dared pray with someone in either the Methodist or Presbyterian. So these people completely enclaved, okay? So there they are, enclaved. We're going to leave them sitting there, okay? They're sitting there. Now let's go to politics. Doesn't this get complicated?
Yeah.
We're eventually going to get to the Bible, too. Okay. 1960s. Well, 1958. We've got the GOP, and we've got the Democrats. And the GOP tries to use, the Republicans try to use school prayer to motivate people. They're starting to look at this group of people. They're not registered. They're not voting. They're not engaged in American politics at all. Somebody wants them. That's a nice chunk of voters. So school prayer doesn't motivate people. 1964, civil rights. Civil rights, what happens is the African Americans that were in the GOP, because of African Americans, because Johnson, who is a Democrat, passes the Civil Rights Act, those African Americans shift over here. Well, one thing I forgot, in the election before that, the Catholics that were in the GOP, they shift over here because of JFK. So they've shifted over. So what's happening is the Catholics are shifting, the African Americans are shifting, and then some of the evangelicals start shifting in the early 70s because of Carter. Now this is a real problem, okay? So we have all this shifting going on. So they're looking for how do we motivate this group of people to get in this column, okay? So this is the original, they tried wedge issues. Tried school prayer, didn't work. And they also tried abortion. 1973, abortion was the topic. So they tried to shift people into this column over the issue of abortion. But the reality is, it's really interesting. The Southern Baptist Conference, from in the early 70s to the mid 70s, they affirmed a woman's right to an abortion for emotional, physical, or mental health reasons, or endangerment to the life of a mother, and they affirmed that life began at birth. This was the Southern Baptist Conference. The only people that were talking in the 1970s, the 1960s, about abortion were right to life Catholics. But no, we know this still, no good evangelical is ever gonna hang out and work with Catholics, right? That's not gonna be happening. Until you need them. Until you need them. Same thing on the marriage issue. Evangelicals combined up with none of them would ever hang out with Mormons until you need them, right? On marriage. So now here we are. They're going to try to make abortion an issue. Doesn't motivate people still. Let's look in 1978. What happens in 1978? Anita Bryant happens. Okay. So the short version of the story is people watch her action in Miami-Dade County. She is trying to motivate the Christians of her county to stop an ordinance that's just been passed that homosexuals cannot be not hired or fired because of their sexual preference. It passes in the county commission. She gets very upset about this, thinking that, oh my goodness, there's going to be lesbians teaching my children in my Baptist school, and we're not going to be able to fire them. So she starts a campaign, Save Our Children campaign. She wins in Miami-Dade County. What she does, though, is she inspires the religious right, the conservative Christians, because now it's about their children. So we're back to an old meme from before that says, watch out for communists and homosexuals, they will recruit your children. So now we're back to that same thing, that the homosexuals are gonna recruit your children. Remember, these tactics often go to what people are gonna do to your children. So she inspires not only the religious right, but she also inspires the gay rights movement in the United States. Okay, now we are in 1980. And they're trying to get a Republican president elected. So here we have Reagan, who Matthew couldn't remember this morning, right? Couldn't remember the Reagan years, but there they are in 1980. So the GOP is trying to get Reagan elected. And they know none of these other issues work. These issues work. They can't talk about abortion. Because in the two terms that Reagan was the governor of this state, they had the most liberal abortion laws in the country. They can't talk about divorce, which was a big topic in the 50s. Like, I was ostracized from my Catholic church as a child because my mother was divorced. They can't talk about divorce and they can't talk about abortion because Reagan had both been divorced and remarried and had the most liberal abortion laws in the country. So thank goodness we had Anita Bryant inspired people, including the televangelists, to start talking about the dirty, filthy gays, okay? Jerry Falwell and the Moral Majority, that was all used to motivate people to put money in the coffers of the religious, the televangelists. But unfortunately, the AIDS crisis hit in 1981. And when the AIDS crisis hit, it cemented in the minds of people that it was God's curse on the gay community for having gay sex. And so it all fit into that same, the same narrative that gay people were threatening. And we're just about to move to the Bible now. And where am I on time? Oh, good. Oh, my goodness. Okay. But what I want to say, which is very sad, and it's often hard to say this and to understand this. So it was in 1986 that Reagan, who did get elected, 1986, that he first said the words publicly, HIV/AIDS. And by the time our president said HIV/AIDS, 21,000 Americans were dead. 36,000 Americans had HIV/AIDS. Now, those of you that also are as old as me, we remember Legionnaires and the Tylenol crisis, and that was on the front page all the time. And less than 20 people died as a combination of those two. And look at all the Americans that were dead. We allowed, in this country, the televangelists to dictate the conversation on who gay people were, that HIV/AIDS was a moral disease, and no religious community said any compassion, except for the MCC, Metropolitan Community Church. No religious community released any compassionate statements about those living with AIDS until 1987 and 1988. For the first 6 years of the crisis, the conversation was dictated by televangelists and people sending out mail like Jerry Falwell telling us about who the gay people were, okay? Now we're gonna drop all that there. Totally drop it, and we are going to move on to the Bible. Yep, we're going to move on to the Bible. This is where you get to be frustrated. Yeah, it's not great. Let's look at first. Okay, let's review first. I'm going to go right where you are. So, anything before this point of history, remember, we didn't understand what sexuality is. We don't understand same-sex attraction. Before it was, if you were taking the role you played, if you took the woman's role, if you were the penetrated, you took the woman's role, the worst thing to be was a woman. Then we started to see, maybe it isn't quite that way. We didn't understand it. Maybe one of the men was like a woman on the inside. It was a mystery for a while. And then some enlightened people told us it was a mental illness and people were broken. And then we started to figure out it was a sexual preference. It was no longer a mental illness. In about the 1990s, 1993, 4, 5, people start calling it an orientation. But it's a progression of understanding. But the important thing along this, what we're going to talk about the Bible right now, is before this point of time, what it was the role you played in sex. So if you played the female role, you were being degraded, or you took the female role, but it was mostly men with young boys, men with someone, a man in a lower class, never equal status men. So it was always some form of lust or abuse or excess. No other way to see this. Even when we read in literature, so people will say, let's look at ancient literature, and there are men with men. There was always, though, an age differential or a power differential. It would have been a powerful man with a less powerful man. In the case of Nero, you know, circumcising his boyfriend and putting him in a bridal gown, that was obviously not a loving, you know, equal status relationship. Okay. Let's look at, why we look at the King James. So this is 1611. And we're going to look at the King James version of the Bible. And it's not that it was the first English version of the Bible, but it was the first version of the Bible with modern English language. In the early 1500s, there had been two versions of the Bible, three versions of the Bible with English language, but it was Middle English. So this is the reason that people look back at the King James. But we're going to see that there are blanket condemnations of same-sex relationships. But if you get anything out of this, please don't use the word homosexual when you're talking about the Bible, because homosexuality is. What we understand is it's a sexual orientation along the spectrum of human sexuality. Sexual orientation includes three things. It includes your identity, your self-identity. It includes your behavior, how you have sex. Do you have sex with the same sex, opposite sex, both sexes, bisexual, whatever, how you have sex. And then it's also your natural attraction. That's something that's never going to change. So we're going to talk about same-sex behavior, not sexual orientation. So please, when you talk about the Bible, talk about same-sex behavior. And clearly, the Bible has very negative views of same-sex behavior. But let's try to look at what they're saying in the Bible and put it in context. So remember, negative views of men taking the female position, always until the 1920s, 30s, 40s, given women's dismissive names put in the place socially and sexually of a woman, not seen positively even to this point in history. So let's see what some of these versions say. Okay. Now we hear these words, we've been hearing them so far in several sessions, that ancient cultures operated in the context of gender hierarchy, right? So we know that males are superior to females in government, intellect, and sex. So the man had to take the dominant position, be the penetrator in sex. That's just one part of patriarchy, or gender hierarchy. So the males were sexually dominant as well. And there's also patriarchy, where the men hold the power. So again, the worst thing that a man could be was to be treated like a woman, and a man had to be in the dominant position. So let's look at the verses. Leviticus tells us, thou shalt not lie with mankind as one does with womankind. It's an abomination. Mankind means resembling a man in form, not a woman, a male. Now that makes sense. You shouldn't treat a male as you would treat a woman because it's an abomination. An abomination is used 117 times in the Old Testament for mixing of things, mixing of seeds in fields, mixing of cloths, mixing of animals that swim in the ocean and walk on the land, just mixing of things. God is trying to keep his people separate. So 117 times in the Old Testament, things are called an abomination. They're culturally wrong, okay? Let's look at Leviticus 20:13 and see if the verse fits within the context of the time. It says that if a man lies with mankind, a male, treating a male as a female, then both of them have committed an abomination. It works still. You shouldn't enter a relationship where you treat a male as a female. Makes sense. It's all good. God's not saying anything that doesn't work along these cultural lines before this. Okay, and this is properly spaced as to where 1611 would be. Next one. Let's look at the Romans verses. And you're going to have to twist your heads again, because if you walk all the way around the room and you go back, that's where first century Rome would be. Now, Paul had an interesting problem in first century Rome. He had to talk. The point of Romans is to tell people that no matter what you do, you're never going to be good enough. You need a savior. It doesn't matter if you're a Jew or a Gentile. You need a savior. So he couldn't talk to the Gentiles about if you break the law, you're going to hell. The Gentiles wouldn't have understood anything about the law. The Jews understood that. So he had to talk to the Gentiles in a way that they understood. And what they understood was Stoicism. And Stoicism was a system of belief they had. And it operated from 300 years BC to about the middle of the second century And Stoicism was a way of connecting and being one with nature. So it was being right with nature. So to be a good Stoic was to be in cooperation with nature. So in that context, a Stoic, to be a good Stoic and to be in relationship, appropriate relationship with nature, had to use self-control. They had to be socially and sexually male dominant, and their sex had to go towards procreation. That's how you were a good Stoic. If you did, it would be equivalent to that. Not being that would be like for a Jew breaking the law. So to be a bad Stoic would be to lack self-control and to be lustful. A man was not in social and sexual dominance, and the sex was not towards procreation. So when we see the scene of Romans 1, 28 through 32, we are seeing a scene in which there is no self-control going on. There are incidences, various kinds, and we don't know, where the man is not sexually dominant, and we know that there's sex going on that is not towards procreation. So that's what we're seeing in Romans 1. So let's look at how that's defined or how that's interpreted in 16:11. Romans 1:26 says, "For even their women did change the natural use against that which is against nature." A woman's natural use would have been to be penetrated, to not be having sex in lust, and to have sex towards procreation. Now, there are many ways that that could not be happening. Non-procreative sex for a woman, she could have been penetrating him with something. She could have been having sex when she wasn't fertile. She could have also been having sex with another woman, but we don't know. We have no idea what she was doing. We just know that she wasn't using self-control. The sex was not male dominant and towards procreation. So we don't know, we can't say it's women having sex with women. We just know that she's not following the Stoics' guidelines of what's in alignment with nature. Romans 1:27 says, "Men leaving the natural use of women start having sex, lust-filled sex with one another." So again, men are leaving the natural use of a woman. Men are not penetrating women. All of this makes sense within the 16:11 version, within our understanding of what sex, same-sex behavior is. It all works. I'm still happy with it. Okay, let's look at 1 Timothy. So who are the people that are ungodly in 1 Timothy? Ungodly and are irreligious and unholy. They are the whoremongers, but those that defile themselves with mankind. Those that do not have appropriate sexual relationships, well, there would be no appropriate sexual relationship to have with another male because one of them would be being penetrated. But those are the people that are ungodly. Still works, though. One person is being used in the female position. Corinthians. Oh, my goodness. There I go. And now, this is an interesting one. So there's two, we've heard this, we've started to understand this weekend. There's two words in Greek, and they are senekoite and malakoi. And right here in Corinthians, in King James 16:11 says, these are the people who aren't going to heaven, including the effeminate and the abusers of themselves with mankind. Okay? Now remember, there are two words. Arsenicoite. There's two words. Arsenicoite, the best understanding we have of arsenicoite is those that defile themselves with mankind. So one of the men is being penetrated, and it's just not a male-female penetrator sexual relationship going on. And this word is incredibly interesting. This word malakoi in the King James translates to effeminate. And effeminate, if I have this list, oh, I do. It's such an interesting list. So this is to behave like a woman, to have the characteristics or traits of a woman. Now, you can imagine that they're not going to be terribly wonderful, glowing traits of a woman. Where are we in history? Okay? Women are, you know, somewhere in the 1800s, we're going to start to catch our stride a little bit. And we might catch it in 1965. But here are the traits associated with a woman, which is what this word effeminate and malakoi mean. Okay, these are the traits associated with a woman. She's morally weak. She's given to unnatural vices. She's lazy, unchaste, lustful, impure, submissive in sex, we get that, but it was also associated with men who were weak in battle, who kind of preened themselves up and became like peacocks for women. Men who were too bookish were Malakoi. And men that fell in love with women and lost control of themselves. So this is often, in modern translations, said to be a man that takes the passive role of being penetrated as a woman. But it's a man that has the immoderate disposition of a woman. It's just saying, a man that's too much like a woman, isn't that an awful thing? Because those people aren't going to go to heaven. Okay, so all of those translations within the context of King James 1611, they all work. Let's see what happens in modern history. Am I still good on time? Oh, I am. Okay, here's the points to get frustrated. Now, remember where we are in this point of history. According to the medical community, people who are gay are mentally ill and broken, okay? The government is saying that they're dangerous and they're gonna recruit children and we need to keep them away from children. We also can't trust them being in government positions. There are people that are gonna betray their country. So they're on the outsides, they're in the shadows, and when we catch them, we really should imprison them, lobotomize them. Gay people are just a dangerous bunch. What a great time to translate the Bible. Right, okay? So, the first translation of the Bible where the word homosexual is going to pop up is incredibly interesting. And people often say it's in the Revised Standard Version of 1946. And that's not entirely true, because if you go to your Bible Gateway or you go to any translation you love online, and you plug in 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 10, and you look up that verse, it doesn't say homosexual. It says sexual pervert. So remember, these two words are synecdoche and malakoi. One of those words is a man treating another male like a woman. Malakoi means to have the immoderate disposition of a woman, to act like a woman, and who wants to do that, okay? So the Revised Standard Version, you know how Bibles are often, they'll translate the New Testament, and then they'll publish that, and then a few years later, they'll translate the Old Testament? Well, that's what happened here. In the 1946 version, where the New Testament was translated, it was first Malakoi and arsenicoite, okay, which have nothing to do with what a woman does with her body, right? It's only how a man behaves, his disposition, and a man penetrating a male. It has nothing to do with women. But in the 1946 version, that verse is going to say, in just the New Testament translation, homosexuals are the ones that aren't going to go into the kingdom of God. Homosexuals. But okay, how does that even happen? Look at the context that this is in. 1946. Look what is happening within the culture. People that translate the Bible, come from their culture. You're not sitting on some mountaintop, you know, singing and waiting for God to speak to you. You're living in the culture. So it was translated first as homosexuals. By the time the Bible came out, it was then translated as, and I don't think I have it, when it finally came out, it got translated as sexual perverts. But look at the context that was in. Within the culture, we were talking about sexual perverts. So that totally made sense within that culture. So what's the worst thing that a man could be in the 1940s and 50s in the United States? A sexual pervert and a homosexual. But when they were talking about that, did they understand who homosexuals were? They had no idea. Homosexuals finally stopped being mentally ill in 1973. We didn't understand that this is really a sexual orientation until about the 1980s and 90s. But this is a cultural translation that the worst thing we could imagine a man being is a sexual pervert, aka homosexual. And I honestly believe if they could have gotten away with it, they would have put communist in that translation too. They would have put communist there, okay? So how did we start to understand? So if when the Bible actually got printed in 1952, when the Old Testament and New Testament got printed together in 1952, the word that was used was not homosexual anymore, it was sexual pervert. So how did the culture start to understand that the sexual perverts they're talking about are homosexuals? Well, in the person that did the commentary on that, it was the first commentary on an American translation that had been written in 50 years. So people paid attention to it. And this man named George Buttrick did the commentary on the Bible. Okay, so he's living in this culture, and he's seeing the worst thing a man could be in that culture was a sexual pervert, a homosexual. And every time he sees arsenicoite or malakoi, or any reference to that in Leviticus, men laying with men, he calls them, in his commentaries, he calls them homosexuals. So it sticks in there. Now let's, which is interesting. So George Buttrick was born in 1892. Let's think about what George might have understood about sexuality, human sexuality. He was born in 1892, and he died in 1980, at the age of 80-something or another. This was the culture that spoke into his life. He didn't understand what a homosexual was. He had no idea what a homosexual was. It was a sexual pervert. That's what he understood, okay? Now, and this is the last part of this piece. The next time the Bible is gonna get translated in a major translation, it's gonna be the Living Bible. Living Bible. It's not, actually, I misspoke. It doesn't get translated, it gets paraphrased. Okay? So the name of the guy is 1972. His name is Kenneth Taylor. Okay, let's put him in context. Where's Kenneth born? Kenneth was born in 1917, and he died in 2005. Old man. But what was the culture he grew up in? What did he understand about people who are homosexual? Were people with same-sex attractions, that they were broken and sick and destructive. He certainly didn't get to this understanding of history. He certainly didn't get to here, where we understand what people with same-sex attractions look like. So George, I mean, now we're in Kenneth. Kenneth is going to write a new version of the Bible, the Living Bible. Oh, so interesting. It's a paraphrase. And he wanted to write this Bible because he wanted a Bible that was easy to read to children. So he created this paraphrase. So Kenneth creates the paraphrase, and he takes arsenicoite and malakoi. So remember, a man that lies with males, age or power differential, a man that excessive sex, excess lust, not a loving relationship, treats another man as a woman, and a man with the immoderate dispositions of a woman. That doesn't even translate in history. This is from times of patriarchy and gender hierarchy. You know, have we been talking throughout the last 2 days of the Bible has been written in certain lenses? The Bible's been written through a lens of patriarchy and gender hierarchy, and it's been interpreted in lenses of gender hierarchy and patriarchy. So we can't understand, like, this word effeminate doesn't work for us today, because it's the worst thing you cannot to be is not a woman. I don't know what the worst thing, in God's eyes, there's not a worse thing you can be. So here we have Kenneth Taylor. So he's writing a paraphrase because it has to be able to be read to children so that children can understand it. Now Kenneth Taylor, who gave us this prize, he had some seminary and no proficiency in Hebrew and Greek, none. And he took those two words and he combined them together to be homosexual. So he didn't eliminate lesbians in this. So somebody this morning was talking about the English Standard Version. Cheryl was talking about it. And I often tell lesbians, if you want to go, you want your ticket to the kingdom of heaven, read the English, use and have on your person the English Standard Bible Version, because it talks about male homosexuals in there and not female homosexuals. So you've got it, like, you've got your ticket out because, you know, you got it and said, God, it doesn't say female homosexuals in my Bible. It says male homosexuals. But so he took both of them together. He took arsenicoite and malakoi and made it homosexual and included lesbians. This is a man, never went to seminary, not proficient in Greek and Hebrew. And so when people say to me, oh, like, Kathy, how can you talk about this stuff? I went to engineering school. I didn't go to seminary either. But you know what? I'm at least doing a little bit better than Kenneth here because I at least, like, know gay people. And I understand this piece of history. And I've studied what these words in context mean. I'm a lot better off than Kenneth was in 1971. But what made this Bible so popular was it was given away as a premium gift at the Billy Graham rallies. So this Bible that says, we're going to read what it says next, they started to give it away in the 1970s at the Billy Graham rallies, okay? Before I tell you what the Bible says, it's the first modern translation in a long time. Paraphrase. By 1996, 40 million copies of this Bible are going to be given away in the context of this history, okay? We're already, gay people are coming out, we're being suspicious of them here, we're really suspicious of them because Anita Bryant's telling us to be suspicious of them. The televangelists are telling us they're the dirty, filthy gays that are coming to get our children. In the context of that, this gem of a Bible comes out and it says, Leviticus, which before said, don't treat a man like you would a woman. Now that Bible is going to say in 1971, homosexuality is absolutely forbidden. It's an enormous sin. Okay? Lying with mankind as you do a womankind is paraphrased. That's what it was before. Treating a man like you do a woman is now paraphrased by a man that doesn't understand Greek and Hebrew as homosexuality. Leviticus 20:13 says, the penalty for homosexual acts, not a man treating another male like a woman, is death. Okay? So lying with a man as you would with a woman now becomes homosexual acts. Romans 1:26, we don't know in Romans 1:26 what women are doing with each other. We just know that they're not being penetrated and the sex that they're having is not towards procreation. Now, in the paraphrase, by the man that doesn't know Greek and Hebrew, even their women turned against God's natural plan. We understand what natural is. Natural is supposed to mean self-control, sex towards procreation, dominant sex by a male. Women turned against God's natural plan and had sexual sin with each other. The Bible doesn't say that, but that's what the New Living Bible did. So natural use, remember, meant self-control, male dominant sex, sex to procreation, and now it's paraphrased as women having sex with women. It's pretty amazing. Okay, Romans 1:27. Instead, the men, instead of having normal sex with women, burned with lust to each other. Yes, they burned with lust in excess. It was an excess. It was not loving, mutual, monogamous relationships. They're not talking about two people of the same sex in a loving relationship. This is the key here. They burned with lust. 1 Timothy. And who are the ungodly? The ones that are irreligious and unredeemable. 1 Timothy, paraphrase, says, he takes that and he says, all who are impure and arsenicoite now, men having sex with males as if they're women, translates that to homosexuals. Okay? And the last part, Corinthians. And who are the ones that are not going to inherit the kingdom of heaven? Included in the long list, of course, are those who are homosexual. Okay? Bible never says that back here, right? Doesn't say it. So he's taking the man that doesn't understand Greek and Hebrew, who's not gone to seminary, is going to take arsenicoite and malakoi, combine them together, call them homosexuals, and include women. Okay? The next time the Bible is going to get translated, and we're not going to show those translations, but the next time the Bible gets translated is in 1996. Yeah, the New Living Translation, which is just an update of this, And you have to look at the people on the translation committee, and the people on the translation committee are 90 evangelical scholars, and they pretty much agree with these translations. So Leviticus is still homosexuality. Romans 1:26 is still women having sex with women. Corinthians, arsenikoite, and malakoi are still combined and are homosexuals. And in Timothy, that translation becomes homosexuals too. Okay? So, I'm totally missing one piece of the discussion. Maybe we'll get it to in questions. So, finally, let's look at what this means. So we can see what the Bible says about same-sex behavior in the context of history. In the context of history, it's all about men treating males like women. Totally makes sense. And then we're going to start to understand human sexuality, but unfortunately, the people that are doing the paraphrases are not catching up with what it means. We understand what human sexuality starts to mean around here, but this version of the Bible, this paraphrase of the Bible, as I said, 40 million copies get into the hands of the American public between 1971 and 1996. In this culture, look at the culture they're speaking into. First of all, we've got all this fear still coming out. We've got the gay rights movement. We don't understand that. In the midst of the AIDS crisis, in the midst of this merger of religion and politics to motivate people to the voting booths and inspiring them with fear, this Bible is sitting within the culture, doing that level of damage. So the destructive consequences, obviously, of misusing scriptures and not understanding what scriptures really say in context is the condemnation of an entire class of people, which in this country is 8 million people, LGBT queer people, about 200 million people worldwide. This has also, in the 1970s, telling us that people were broken and could be fixed. It's a whole nother topic. Spurned the reparative therapy movement. So I think the worst years to be gay in this country in terms of oppression from the reparative therapy movement and the government were from about the 1980s to 1992. Everybody was it. So the churches were telling you could be fixed. And the AIDS crisis was going on. All of this oppression was going on against the LGBT community. And it also forced people into mixed orientation marriages. And I can assure you that I know that a lot of you in this room have been a gay person married to a straight person as a result of being told that you could change and that there was something wrong with you. But you got to realize what happened here is, remember we went along this timeline and the therapists, the medical community figured out that gay people weren't mentally ill and broken, and that sat as a growing progressive thought for a few years. And then all of a sudden, in the 1980s, we come back after the Anita Bryant, this whole merger, and we lay back on the gay community something we've already figured out isn't right. We say they are recruiting our children, they are mentally ill, they are broken, they can change, but now we wrap it up in a Bible, okay? So these are the consequences, and the other consequences, so people get forced into mixed orientation marriages, but there's also, I wrote a book. So it's out there, but it's called Walking the Bridges Canyon. So I cover the history in a lot of it, and then I do, which I didn't get a chance to do, is human sexuality, a chapter on human sexuality, but that's also online. So there's a free chapter online, the audio of human sexuality. It's a pretty good chapter. Then I do the Bible. And then I talk about reparative therapy, the history of that movement, mixed orientation, and the consequences of people that are gay, getting married to people that are straight. And then I also cover the history of the LGBT Christian movement, which didn't just start with Matthew. It started in 1968. Troy Perry was asking, banging on the church door, saying, include us. So this is not a new conversation. People have been trying to have this conversation since 1968 with the church, but finally the church is listening. Also, another consequence of this is LGBT youth. What we're doing to LGBT youth, and I just have to say these consequences. When we try to pressure LGBT youth to not accept themselves for exactly who they are, by the time that they are young adults, they suffer 8 times more suicide attempts, 6 times more depression, 3 times more likely to have drug and alcohol abuse, and 3 times more likely to contract HIV, STDs. And what we're also suffering by not understanding this is we are cutting out for reasons, these nebulous reasons that we believed and we've not understood the underlying foundation of how this happened, our witness to the world of not accepting people that are perfectly normal and perfectly healthy and created in God's design, our witness to the rest of the world by rejecting this entire community damages our witness as Christians. It totally damages us. So honestly, wherever you are in this conversation and afterwards, people that are watching this online, I hope what I've done is undermined what you believe you know about human sexuality, because here's the reality, okay? So let's stand here. Here we are in 2016, and we're looking, remember, all around the room and back again at Romans 1, and we are ignoring all of this. All of this. To say that Paul understood that he was talking about homosexuals, people that are homosexuals, same-sex attracted. And even worse, let's zip around the room again and come back to 14th century BC and say that those writers understood all of this. It's ridiculous. So again, in my book, in chapter 15, I explain to people that all the resources that are out there, including Gay Christian Network, Reformation Project, there's books out there that can help you, PFLAG chapters, but how people can get engaged in the conversation and find out some facts and some truths. And the last thing I want to leave you with is just a blessing that maybe you will consider that there's some truth in what I've said and that it undermines your thinking and that it undermines the way in which you view scripture. And so it's something I end my book with, and I say, may God bless your journey in the wilderness. May he raise your level of understanding. May he make low the mountains of discrimination. May he smooth the ground for an accurate witness of God in the world. And I really hope people start to understand that the Bible is not against LGBT people. It is not, it has been used that way. So I hope that this gives you more tools to engage the topic. Remember I said in the beginning that my struggle was engaging this topic just on talking about scripture. There's so many ways to enter this conversation. And I hope that you can learn that there are more ways and then possibly engage people in maybe a safer place to say, do you understand about human sexuality? Do you understand that we didn't even know what sexual orientation was until this point, that Paul couldn't have understood this? So I hope this gives you another way of understanding the Bible as it intersects sexual orientation and gender identity, okay? Thank you.